thank you for having me here. Good evening. What a great bunch of stories that you've been hearing through the day. I just caught bits of it. What I've called my session is that, you know, how do you kind of grow or transform as at the speed of dreams? Because I think what entrepreneurs have is this amazing ability to dream and kind of think of things that nobody else can see at that stage. So first of all, in the interest of full disclosure, I'm not an entrepreneur, right? I've never been. So I have a very simple resume. I was a lawyer for 10 years, and then I ran an airline for about 10 years, and now I run a hotels business. So I'm actually not an entrepreneur at all. But what I've been able to do is I've had the good fortune of having worked with entrepreneurs and founders for a long period of time, and in each one of the opportunities that I've been involved in, we've gone through an amazing hyperbolic expansion, and we've taken companies and ideas from where it was literally a piece of paper to where they're seen as one of the largest or most recognized brands or ideas in the country and in various parts of the world. So just talking about Oyo, and thanks for that plug. So we are actually now in 80 countries. Oyo is a six-year-old company, and we are now in 80 countries. We are the third largest branded hotel chain in the world. And there are a few myths about Oyo that I wanted to clarify straight away. We're not a marketplace. We're not an aggregator. We're not some certification company or an online travel agency. We're a full-stack hotel company. So what that basically means, and this is some things that people don't know much about, but we actually do everything that a full hotel company does, like the one we are staying in today. Whether it is leasing a piece of property, or whether it is converting it, or whether it is putting capex in it and transforming it, or running the hotels and the housekeeping and the revenue management, the pricing and all of that. So we're a full stack hotel company, actually. And that's important to keep that in mind because of just the sheer pace at which this company grows and this concept grows. So clearly, the opportunity is staring at us. But at the same time, I think the future is not what it used to be. This is a very famous line from Yogi Berra. And if you have all those folks who ever want to get a quick laugh out of things, you should go and look up Yogi Berra quotes. He's got some amazing, funny quotes. So before that, I want to tell you a little bit of a story, and the story is about scale and what and how to kind of think about growth. And the story is an Indian parable about this guy who invents the game of chess, and he comes and he presents it to the king. The king is very impressed, and he wants to reward the inventor. And he asks that, you know, what do you want? You know, what can I offer you as an award? So he says, look, it's okay. I don't need very much. He said, no, seriously, I want to reward you, and this is just a great game. It's so complex, so intelligent. So he says, okay, I want one grain of rice for the first square, and then another two grains of rice for the second square, and three grains of rice for the third square, and that's all I'm looking for, some grains of rice. So the king obviously says, okay, sure, that sounds pretty simple. And most of you are engineers, MBAs, unlike me, so you can do the math. So what actually happens is that by the time you get to the 64th square, you've got a heap of rice which is taller than Mount Everest. So, as you set up to transform companies, and as you set up to look at scale, I think what's important is to first answer the question as to why do you really need to scale up? Because there are some great businesses, there are some great products and brands that I have a lot of respect for, which do not scale up or haven't scaled up, but have created great brands and great products out of just creating perfection in something really small. You know, these famous Michelin star Japanese chefs, where their whole life they run a restaurant which is 18 covers or 20 covers, but people line up for 3 years just to get a table to come and have a meal. And in these restaurants, you don't even have a menu. The chef gives you what he decides to give you on that particular day. And he has so much confidence and dedication to his art that people just come in to experience that one meal and wait for 3 years and plan a trip to Tokyo to come and eat at that restaurant. So success doesn't actually mean that you have to scale up or become big. So therefore, at the stage of many of the businesses that you might be involved in today, the very first question to answer is, why do I really need to scale up? And I think it's important, like we set out in the case of Oyo, is to try to solve for a fundamental problem. And that fundamental problem is this. I don't know about you, but if you grew up like me in India in the last 20, 30 years, in most cities, if you would walk off a strange city off a plane or a bus or a train, the first argument you're going to have is with a tout. And depending on what, how much he's getting paid that extra 50 rupees in, he's going to take you to a hotel or a guest house that he has a preference for. And then once you get to that hotel, depending on what clothes you're wearing or bags you're carrying or whether you have kids with you or it's the middle of the night or the day, you're charged anywhere between 500 rupees to 5,000 rupees. At this moment in time, you're getting cheated. It is only a question of how much you're getting cheated, right? And what's happened in the last 4 or 5, 6 years is this one red and white sign has meant that you can come off any street and you don't have to ask anybody where the hotel is going to be located. You don't have to negotiate with anyone for that price of that hotel. And for the price of about 3 or 4 cups of coffee, you get a standardized room and a bed to sleep and air conditioning and a geyser and television and cable TV and a customer relations and so on and so forth. So there has to be a fundamental need that we are trying to solve. So over the next about half an hour, I'm going to share with you some learnings that I had over the last 20 years being involved in transforming or scaling up businesses. So the first lesson that I learned was that we only scale up if there is a certain big, larger purpose that you're trying to solve. So the next question is the choices you make. Scaling up is always about, or transforming companies is always making some really tough choices. And I'll take you through a bunch of these choices that you might be facing today, and I certainly faced over the last 15 years. And they all seem to be diametrically opposite. And depending on the choices you make, and hopefully you'll make a few larger bunch of right choices versus the bad ones, which will take you to where you want to need to get to. So the very first choice is between having targets or one clear big objective. So for instance, in the business that I was involved in the last 10 years running an airline, or when we were starting up our business back in 2006, or when Oyo started up 6 years ago, there are always big targets that you set for yourself. And you're going to talk to investors and making pitch presentations, and there are revenue projections, and there's a plan. And you know, and the investor knows, that plan is worth nothing, and it's going to change, but you spend so much time putting up all this PowerPoint presentation doing that, you know, all the cool graphics and the data points. On the other hand, the lesson that I had was, if you kind of think of one big objective that you're driving towards, that stays consistent over a period of time. While targets may change year to year or month to month, that is what one needs to focus on. So, in the case of Oyo, for instance, we said, our goal, our one big objective is to create quality living spaces. And that can be in a holiday resort, that can be in budget accommodation, that can be in mid-scale brands, that can be in the largest wedding banquets business that we own, or we just announced our co-working business. In every place, can you create a more affordable quality living space? And that is not a target that changes, but that is one big objective that you're trying to chase. And I'll talk about Indigo in just a bit too. So the lesson I learned is there needs to be a larger purpose that the whole company or we are trying to chase year on year. And that stays pretty consistent, just like values stay consistent for us. The next question, after you've figured out that you want to be in the hotels business or the airline business or the tech business or whatever you're trying to solve, often people end up asking, what do customers want, right? And you're trying to solve for what that customer wants. And in the businesses that I've been involved in, customers actually want a whole bunch of things. There's only one slight problem that I've figured out with customers. They don't want to pay for it. I don't know if it happens to you or not, but I always end up going to customers who don't want to pay for all the things that they want. So the next lesson I learned for myself is, it's more important to solve for the needs of the customer than all the wants. So the airline story that I often give is, when I used to run an airline, more often than not, you know, if I did a customer survey right here, which we never did at Indigo, by the way, here's what I probably hear. You know, you should make your seats a little bit bigger. And you should make a separate line to check in. And yet, 5 minutes late, aa sakte hain. And I don't know why you're so adamant about charging for that extra 1 kilo, right? And, you know, that rajma chawal, I don't know. Like, you know, look at Vistara, you know, they give that chocolate mousse and all of that. And all the airlines who have gone out of business, if you check their ads out, it'll always be a tray of food and a Czechoslovakian air hostess taking it through and the sunlight coming in and all of that kind of stuff. And the question that I always ask myself is, you're sitting in front of the computer with your credit card about to book an airline ticket and you're like, no. I don't care about on time or hassle free. What's that airline that gives that rasgulla? Never happens. We all want airlines to be like hotels. But when was the last time you were coming into land and you had a great flight? I mean, it was just a fabulous flight, right? You loved it, the screen, the TV and everything. And it was coming into land and you went up to the pilot, sir, 1 more hour, sir. Late landing, please. Customers want what they need. And the idea of the business should be to be able to solve for that need, and which is basically, what will the customers pay for? The next question when you're ramping up is between cost and quality, right? And you're constantly trying to make this choice, and you're trying to think that, you know, as I scale up, you know, I'm either going to spend more money, if I cut down on my costs, I'm going to lose on quality. And fortunately, I'm involved in a business today, and I was able to be a part of a business for the last decade or so, where we were able to consistently prove that low cost has nothing to do with low quality. By the way, these are real pictures and all of these are Oyos. So whether it's a castle in France or whether it's a, you know, a hotel in London or a hotel in China, these are all real Oyos. Right? And therefore, the lesson that is very, very important to learn is that low cost does not have to do anything with low quality. Right? If spending more money was the only way to get customers through the door, then there would be another blue or a red colored airline in this country. It's true. But as ridiculous as that, you know, and as example sounds, just think back of how many times you sat down with your management teams and somebody said, we've got to throw more money at this problem, and that's the only way to solve for quality. So the next question is, you know, what do you do with all these ideas that keep coming to you, right? And since I never went to business school, I can make this joke. I do it all the time. That, you know, the problem with going to business school is that you have all these great ideas, and you learn the skill of looking them real, making them look really, really pretty, right? And but when all these ideas come in, again, the difficult choice you're making as an entrepreneur is, do I chase all these ideas, or do I have a plan and a process for it? Right. What if someone else takes this idea away from me? Will I be too late in the market to come up with that idea? While you're still working on the five ideas that we did not make a success out of at the moment. So the lesson I learned is, hope is not a plan. Right? You have to put the bad news out there. Whether you're a team member talking to your leader or founder, or whether it is the entrepreneur painting that canvas that we want to paint, you've got to put the bad news out there first. Because once we know what the problem is, we can at least attempt to find a way to solve for it. But if you hope that it'll never happen to me, it's never going to work.